his journey because of a prayer. And that prayer started not long after I became the chief of my people. Reluctantly, that I had not really wanted that to occur. But my Grams, you know, led my people for 68 years because we're not a voting tribe. We're a successional leadership tribe. And so I always hoped that that day would never come, that it kind of fell on my shoulders. But it did. And one of the first actions that we took was to dance on Shasta Dam in opposition to them raising it 20 more feet high, which they're still working on now. So during that time, there were many songs that came in, and one of the warrior songs was about the old-time salmon, the Lindada Noor. And when the Lindada Noor came in, one of the reasons that we danced was to tell the world, you know, we're a very small people, we don't have enough representation in the state or anywhere else, we don't have a whole lot of capital behind us to do any commercials or anything. So what we had hoped for and prayed for was that we would tell the world what's going on here a second time to a people who's recovering from the Holocaust of the California experience, to the taking of our land, to the blocking of our river, and losing our home the same time the salmon lost their home. And we believe that whatever happens to the salmon happens to us. And so the salmon are also in an extinction fall right now. And, you know, when we look at ourselves, we're in that same fall. You know, if we don't change something, then the salmon of Wagana will be gone. There won't be any more Winamum Wintu who sing to the river, who dance on the land, who go to the sacred places and pray. Because that's the Winamum's jobs. Right? And the salmon's job is to come up the river and bring life. When they come up the river, that's what they do. Their DNA is in those trees that still stand on the river. You know, it's still in the soils. Still yet. So the memory is still there about them. So we told the world, and at that time, New Zealand answered and said, "We have your salmon. Would you like them back?" And of course, we would like them back. But we didn't know how. We didn't know, you know, a whole lot about that. But then again, about a year and a half later after that, another pair came in, and we have to go. We have to put that dance down for the salmon. And at the time, it's like, New Zealand, where in the heck is that? It's like, where's New Zealand? And you start doing some research, right? And it's like, oh man, it's halfway around the world, you know? And then you look at the ticket prices, you can't swim there, right? So, okay. And it seems like that's gonna be a major problem, right? And then we find out from, you know, I had some contacts in at the UN, and asking them, where do they know where our salmon are in New Zealand, right? We don't know what river they're in. And so they do some research for us, and they say, oh yeah, they're in the South Island. It's like, oh, there's two islands? Like, okay, it's South Island. Now we've kind of narrowed it down. And now we have to find the people who have been taking care of the salmon. And we find out that it's the Naitahu people. We don't know any Naitahu people, right? And so we can't go there unless they say it's okay for us to dance on their lands. And so we finally get connected to them, and they say, oh yeah, the salmon will be running in 4 months. It's like, oh, we got 4 months. It's like, we don't know anything about passports and the length of time it takes to get a passport, and the amount of money it costs for each passport. And then, not only that, like my sister was saying, our tribe are not flyers. No frequent flyer miles. And most of them avoid any kind of flight anywhere. Like, can't drive there, I guess I'm not going. So we had a lot of things on our plate to shift around. But like the salmon, when they come in, there's nothing that stops them from doing and carrying out their job or their prayer or their direction to their home. And so we didn't at all let it bother us that we didn't have any money or that we were trying to figure out how many could go. It's like, how many needs to go? Could just four of us go and kind of put down that dance and prayer and song? And then another person would say, oh no, we'll go. It's like, okay, now what? And then we find some more money. And eventually we took 28 people with us.
Nice.
28 people, which was necessary to put down that dance and do the whole experience. And it was a boost for the tribe, as well as we feel like it was a boost for those salmon. You saw us let those little salmon out in the buckets. Well, about 3 or 4 years later, the fishery guy, he calls me up and he says, you know, there was an extraordinary run this year. There was a lot of salmon that came in, and we didn't know where they came from because they weren't clipped, right? They clipped that dorsal fin. And all of the salmon that we let loose, that didn't happen to them. So all these salmon started coming in that was unclipped. And then they finally remember, it's like, oh yeah, it's those Winnemums. And so we have a big job still to do in bringing our salmon home. You know, that was just one thing that we did on this journey to bring them back. And it becomes more and more critical that more people realize that these salmon need to come back. Right now in the state of California, all four runs of salmon are endangered of disappearing, and the spring run and the winter run are pretty much on the endangered species list. The fall run is plummeting at all the time. They keep trying to revitalize the runs and, you know, get them, but they're not doing what the salmon need to be healthy and, you know, continuing on. And that's partly because of all the dams that have been installed with no fishway around them, which they said at the time in the 1940s, there was a fishway established for the Shasta Dam, but they said it was too expensive. It was like $130,000 to make this fishway so the salmon could swim, and it was proven that they would swim it. They swam up a redwood planked trough all the way till they could get to the river. And nowadays, of course, they say, well, we don't know if they'd use a fish ladder, because the fish ladders we built, they don't use them, right? But there are many things that common scientists nowadays still do not know about salmon. They have done some tests, they have done some research, but the timing element in salmon has not been figured out by the modern day scientists as to what in a salmon makes them not spawn for 500 miles or 200 miles or 100 miles, you know, in them. Because each of these salmon coming from these rivers have a timer that they can't drop their eggs sooner than they get there. So they can't decide, you know, we're here in Sacramento now, and we'll just spawn because I don't want to go any further. It's in them that this gene drives them to make it back to the very spawning area that they were hatched. And the scientists don't know why that occurs. So they think they could take these hatchery fish that have been probed and done to and put them in the Cloud River and that they'll make it. And I say, you know, it's like taking us, right, this group, we're gonna run the triathlon. I don't know how many of us is going to finish, but I don't think I am, right? And so the Sacramento River is a valley river. It just runs up the valley. There are no real jumps, you know, there's some things they have to avoid and stuff, but it's nothing compared to the McLeod River. McLeod River is, you have to climb that mountain, and the water is coming down faster, colder, and more aerated than the Sacramento River is. It's a completely different river. And so if you take these couch potato salmon and stick them in that river, you can pretty much guarantee they're not gonna make it. And I think that that's what they wanna prove, is that the salmon cannot be restored to the McLeod River so that they don't have that issue to deal with in raising the dam by 18 and a half feet. So we're in a conflict with NOAA and BOR about bringing back our salmon. And the fishery in New Zealand this last summer said, sent us a text and said, you can show this to NOAA. It's like, we have 400,000 eyed eggs. Do you want them? It's like, so we can get as many eyed eggs from New Zealand as necessary to reestablish the runs on the McLeod without ever bothering the endangered species salmon that the California has now, which seems like an ideal, right? Mm-hmm. An ideal. The original salmon from that river with that timing gene already in them, that they would jump at that, right? Seems like a scientist would say, yeah, let's do that, let's try that, you know? Send our salmon way over there, now it's time for them to come back. What a documentary that would make, that it actually happened. And there is a tributary right around in Anderson area, of Cow Creek, that runs up to Dry Creek, and it would go right into the lake. And going right into the lake, they would have 6 miles in the lake to swim to get to the McLeod River. But of course, the scientists come back and say, well, we are afraid that they will get lost in the lake. It's pretty big, it's 370 miles around. And I was like, where did they just come from? I think they came from the ocean, right? And they found their tributary, I mean, they found their estuary, right? Somehow, out of that big ocean, they didn't go up the wrong estuary. All the salmon find their right estuary. And then they start swimming up river. So in my mind, it's like, what kind of little excuse is that? They're going to get lost in the lake. And then it's like, well, we're worried because the current goes that way towards the dam. The original river runs that way to the dam. And we're going to try to make them come across to the tributary and down lower than the dam. So they said, well, the fry won't know how to go out because the science of it is right now that they know about is that the fish follow the smell of the water, right? You heard that? Mm-hmm. So we think that's one sliver of information about fish finding their way home. It's just like tribes, when you separated them in the state, like our tribe was taken out to Eureka and then docked down in Russian Fort, and then some of our guys went hunting and saw Mount Shasta up their way, and many of them made it home. Right? So it's a big circle around, it's like, gotta go home. And these salmon are in that same category of being home, you know. That's why the tribes were in certain territories and then just mix. Like, they didn't just, like, Hoopa is on this side of us, Pitt Rivers are on this side of us, but the languages stayed pure even. There was no slang language of the North State or any of the groups of establishing some sort of a pidgin vocabulary back and forth. It's like either you spoke my language or you didn't. The respect was there. So many of the people in the North State spoke 4 or 5 different languages. If you were a runner, you might speak up to 8 languages. But you never had, even married partners, wherever they live, that's the language their kids would talk. It wasn't like, you know, let's borrow that word and we're gonna make this separate language so when we come together, you can all speak this language and you go home and you speak those languages. It didn't happen that way. And so the same principle is with the fish and them getting back to the exact space that they came from. And there's many things that they don't know about. And so we're saying, the salmon run, the run for salmon that we're doing right now, is we're trying to wake the people up in the state to say, one, we have to speak up for the salmon. We have the voice. We have the avenues to make this happen. The fish do not. They're not even like cute aquarium kind of fish, right? You can't keep them. They only do things one time, and then it's done. So it's not like having a little tropical fish in your tank. It's like, oh yeah, there's those little salmon, it's getting bigger. And then it's gone, right? So we have to use our voices. We have to start recognizing what it is we can do. What can we do about this? And so the Run for Salmon, which will start at Sagorte or Glen Cove over in Vallejo, where the estuary starts, that it's the largest estuary on the Pacific coast. And one of the things that we need to do is protect that estuary, because it's like a nursery. It does all kinds of amazing things for all kinds of animals and fish that we don't even know about. But salmon are one of them, and the Delta smelt is the other species that we really got to talk up for, because they're getting to the extinction level. You know, they are documented to have been here more than 6,000 years. Coincidence, so we documented by some fire pit. But we could have told them without that test. They've been here that long. So these little Delta smelt used to be in the thousands, even millions. These fish would be in that, because they're all a part of that cycle of changing. And the salmon need the Delta smelt to get ready to go upriver. If they're going up the Sacramento River or the San Joaquin River, they need all of that smelt to get them prepared, because when they make that run, they're no longer eating the way that they did. They're getting to their nesting ground. That's the focus. So we're going to truck from Sagorte. We're going to set down a prayer there for the fish coming in. And it's on the 17th of this month, which is prime for winter run coming into the river system. And so we're targeting winter run salmon and singing and dancing for them to let them, to show this way that they are coming in. And so there'll be a walk from that point over to Port Chicago in Martinez area, I think it is, where the Sacramento River actually comes down into the Delta. And from there, we have one boat, one boat that will go up the Sacramento River to Sacramento to Discovery Park. We'll have a number of vehicles that follow, just because those riverfront roads are a little bit more dangerous to run or bike or be on them. Then we have manpower to escort the runners and stuff. So, and then once we get to Sacramento, we're going to do some lobbying on fish behalf. We're going to do some sign waving, maybe at the BOR office. You know, they don't like that kind of stuff, but we have to wake them up. We have to be reminders for them. You know, it might be him and Noah. We're not really sure who can say the fish can come back. Is Noah and BOR like pointing at each other? No, I think it's them. Noah's like them. Nope. And then it's like, oh yeah, it's Feinstein. It's Congress. Like, take it out of our realm. It's only Congress can decide these things. And that's like a mystical thing, right? It's gods. They can't hear me, so I need a little more help reaching the gods. Anyway, we're going to do a concert on the 21st in Sacramento. For those of you who don't know Naco Bear, he's going to be there. We can't advertise him, but he's going to host the whole thing, and he probably will play a song or two. But we have a number of artists who have donated their time to perform, who are fairly good people. And I don't know how many of you know Pua Case and Havani Rios, but they'll be there. And then a couple of the local leading bands in the Sacramento area will be there. And we'll talk again about the salmon and what we can do about that. We'll also have a meeting at the Capitol steps. We got a permit for that, so we shouldn't be carted off at that point. But we do we'll have our signs. And, you know, it's like the state does have something to do with the return of the salmon on these rivers. It's a state river. It's a federal dam, but it's a state river. And the McLeod is supposed to be protected by the Wild and Scenic Resource Code for California. They'll have to change that to be able to flood it. And one of the major problems is salmon. So they've been sued, right? They don't want to do this. They were taken to court and they were sued over the biological opinion about salmon recovery. And the biological opinion says the only way that salmon can recover is to put them above the rim dams. And there's five dams that are named, which Feather River and McLeod are two of the rivers that are named in that, so they have to get them above the Orville Dam and Shasta and three other dams. So they want to start with Shasta Dam because of the winter run salmon. Apparently, they just figured out that the only winter run salmon in California is and should be on the McLeod, because McLeod is run by a glacier river runoff, the coldest river pretty much in the state. So now they want to bypass that and install their hatchery fish from the Livingston Stone Hatchery. And we oppose that. It's like we have the option. This is the only river that has an option to bring back the original fish. Why wouldn't we do that? So we have that option that no other rivers have. And so we're saying, if you can't bring back the New Zealand salmon, then start with another dam, because your only option is hatchery fish for Feather River. You only have that option. So start over there and see if your methodology is going to work, right? Because they want to, their plan. Just 3 years. It's like, I'm sitting there at the table with the biologist. It's like, why would you agree to a three-year plan for a salmon? Why in the world? It's like, did you forget the life cycle of a salmon? It's like, it's more than 3 years. It's like, you put eggs in there, are you thinking it's like 2 weeks or something before they hatch, and they're going to grow up and you're going to take them out in a month? It's like, these salmon, and they really don't know. You know, they admittedly say they don't know. It's like, oh gosh. You know, what is the purpose of a three-year project then? Because what they want to do is take adult salmon from the hatchery, turn them loose at Dina, which is like 2 miles to the PG&E Dam. And these adult salmon are supposed to find a place to spawn in that 2 mile section. And we're saying, you need to let them go at the McLeod Bridge. At least they have, you know, 14 or 15 miles of river to find spawning areas. They don't want to do that. And then they want to put up the encatchments on the river, and we haven't come to any decision about that because we have many sacred places on the water, right? We're the Windham Mim, the middle water people. Water being a key word there, meaning many of our sacred sites are in the water. So these pools are very important to us, and you can't be bolting your encatchment in the sides of our rocks on the river. And you can't be digging into the bed to set the encatchment there. And then we're saying, well, how many fish can you put in that encatchment? Well, if they were all 2 inches like they are in the hatchery, we can get this many fish. But we don't know how many if they're bigger than that. It's like, how big do you think they're going to be when they come back down the river? Well, we really don't know. We don't have wild fish that we follow, right? And so it's like, are you thinking 24/7 encatchment plan you got going on? That you're going to start in, what, 6 months? You think they'll be hatched and start coming out? Or is it a year? Or how many? And they don't know. They have to monitor these things. And so it's like, are you thinking they're all going to come out at the same time? I mean, you guys dump millions of fish into the river. That's unnatural and creates bait ponds, right? Everything that eats little fish shows up at the dumping spot because it's easy lunch. And they don't really know. They really don't have that plan down. And these little fish, it's like they're depending on these salmon. Who knows what their timing is for spawning? Is going to have 2 miles to spawn because they're ready, right? I guess we know that they're ready to spawn during the time that put them in there, because they're not really truly winter run salmon. They say they're remnants of maybe, perhaps, winter run salmon, because hatchery practices have been so poorly done over the years. They didn't really realize what they were doing in the beginning of those things, where they would take buckets of eggs, take a salmon and milk that bucket, and then they take another salmon and milk the bucket again, and another one and milk it again, not realizing that the first milk that they put on those eggs fertilized all the eggs. So they were trying to make diverse eggs, but the first one, it's like, you can't fertilize it again. You know? And then for the winter run especially, because it's cold, it's wet, these salmon are pretty big, and the people who were doing this process would not pick up the huge 80-pound salmon to milk the eggs with. And so now we have the standard size of salmon that everybody thinks, oh yeah, those are big salmon, it's 45 pounds, you know, huge. But we're arguing with BOR about, you know, we have stories of 80 to 100 pound salmon in the river. And then not long after that, because they were saying, oh no, you know, those are stories. You know, we just tell big fish stories. One that got away. But during one of the runs, the Fish and Game actually recovered a carcass of an 85 pound salmon. And he's holding it up and it's just huge. And this is when it already lost weight. And so it's like, see, here's proof. We're not just telling stories. But it is, it's a difficult process when you're up against scientific jargon and facts that they think they have the clearer picture of how to do this. And it's like I'm saying, you know what? How long have you known that? That fish need cold water, that these fish need, you know, whatever it is they have listed, spawning and all of that, timing and that. But you've known this for all this time, and yet the fish are plummeting. So time to change the science, wouldn't you think? It's like, if I'm going to give you a different strategy, why would you use truck and haul? When we already know truck and haul really doesn't produce the return. And so they're going to continue to use failed methods on the fish. It's like, well, could you do that on the Feather River? Because we don't want, and they're saying, it's okay because the fish are all going to die anyway, so it doesn't really affect the river if you still want to bring back your New Zealand salmon. But we're saying it does affect the river because these salmon spawn in their own beds. And if there's another salmon that had spawned in there, then there's less choices of the ones coming up. And they haven't studied those things. You know, they don't really know. It's like eagles using some other eagle's nest. You know, it's not going to happen. And the salmon, even though they'll say, salmon find their way back to their exact spawning area where they were hatched. It's like, listen to that. And so if another salmon used that spawning ground, are they going to go back and spawn there? It'd be better to have a fresh river that has never been spawned in since they left to have the choices of where to spawn. So it's all possible. It's doable. It's cheaper. You know, we pay as taxpayers $80 million a year to run the cold water pool from Redding to Red Bluff for the spawning of salmon that has never produced the projected number of spawning salmon from the very beginning in the 40s, you know, 45. And so why are we going to build the dam higher, have a bigger cold water pool, and run more cold water down the river that doesn't produce spawning? it's like there are only so many spawning beds. And then they say, we're going to dump gravel in the river to create more spawning, right? It's like, do you not know that the river moves the rocks around the way that the river wants it? So if there are no rocks there, it's probably because the river moves them all. It's like, but you know, man can create anything and do anything and manage. And I, and now I just say, you know what, we are in the, what is the industrial era? We're in the man age time.
Anthropocene.
They're in the man age. Everything that's man in his age that is now, that he touches, plummets to nothing. Everything. I mean, you look at Orange County. Is there oranges there anymore? Yes. Oak Grove. Where's the Tule River? It's like, they're gone. It's like, don't name us. Okay. Yeah, and we live right at Bear Mountain, and Bear Mountain has bears still. And so every time the crowds start moving in, it's like, oh, it's like they're gonna build their houses a little too close. Then there's gonna be a problem. Then they're gonna go up there and kill all the bears. That's the process. So the salmon run. So we get to Sacramento. We're gonna take a motorboat to Colusa. From Colusa, we will bike ride to the Woodson Bridge above Chico, and then from there there'll be runners that will run to Cow Creek, where there'll be different ceremonies along the way. And at Cow Creek, because that's where we want the salmon to break off and go up the new waterway. That waterway will bypass our village and into the Shasta Dam. And then we'll have paddlers, boat paddlers, if you have canoe or kayak or something like that. We're gonna paddle around where the fish would swim the new waterway up to the McLeod Bridge.